Good morning, I'm Rebecca Madden. We are breaking into programming this hour to bring you the latest on the incident in Melbourne CBD last night. The Premier Daniel Andrews and Police Commissioner are addressing the state right now. Let's listen in.
Toyota Orion sedan turned out of Elizabeth Street and drove into Bourke Street. It then continued along the tram lines until it was up around Swanson Street. As it crossed over there, it veered from the left of the tram lines and collided with three pedestrians to the right. Those pedestrians were injured quite seriously, and I'll come back to those shortly. The vehicle then continued along Bourke Street up to the intersection with Russell Street, where it in effect T-boned a Hyundai sedan that was travelling north in Russell. That vehicle was knocked onto another vehicle, a Mazda sedan, which was an Uber, and a collision obviously occurred at that intersection. Tragically, a 76-year-old male from Brunswick who was in the Hyundai that was T-boned was killed at the scene, and our hearts go out to his family and friends. It's quite a tragedy that that's occurred, obviously. The Uber driver in the Mazda, he and his passenger only received minor seatbelt injuries. The driver, who I'll now refer to as the suspect, who was in the white Toyota that was driving up Bourke Street, the suspect got out of his vehicle and stood on the roof of it, and he was making some rantings and utterings. Fortunately, three police officers who were on duty, who were returning to the station, came upon the scene courageously and quickly. They acted and arrested that male, and he was taken into custody. Obviously, all emergency services turned out to the scene. That the male is still in custody. He's under police guard at this time in hospital. He has been deemed unfit for interview at this time. What I can say in respect to that male is he's a 26-year-old from Melton West. He has no prior criminal history. He's not on bail. He's in effect a clean skin, for a term used by Victoria Police, for someone who's not had police involvement. The only record we have of that male is that he has had a report of missing person before, and in 2020 we had some involvement with him for a mental health transfer. We've obviously examined this incident quite extremely closely. We've had major collision at the scene, reconstructing it, and they will piece together what's actually happened. They're assisting the homicide squad at this stage, who have primacy for this investigation. The scene was cleared at 7:30 a.m. this morning. As I said, homicide still have primacy and have been unable to interview the suspect at this time. Our counter-terrorism command has assessed all their intelligence holdings and liaised with ASIO. There is nothing known in relation to terrorism to connect this in any shape or form at this time. As I said, the male has no criminal history. Obviously, we will have reassurance patrols out in the city today and making sure that the public can feel reassured. Melbourne is a tremendously safe city. Obviously, this will bring up memories and trauma for all those who were involved in the 2017 incident in Bourke Street, and our hearts go out to them. And I just provide the assurance that we will have those visible patrols, and I would urge them, if they do need assistance, to seek that assistance. I think that is pretty much a summary of the matter, other than the injuries to the three people who were struck initially as the vehicle crossed over Swanson Street. There was a 26-year-old male from Kew who is currently in hospital with a suspected fractured pelvis and head trauma. There was a 35-year-old woman from the Docklands with a suspected broken arm and head injuries, and a 23-year-old woman from China with a suspected fracture to her neck, a broken pelvis, and other injuries. All three of those are in hospital. I would describe them as being in a stable condition. We, as I said, will continue the investigation. When we can interview this suspect, we will. Homicide has primacy. We are still working through to determine whether this is a deliberate or a reckless act. We will take into account all of the evidence from the reconstruction, as well as that occurs at the scene by our major collision investigation unit, as well as considering the history of this male as we further progress the investigation. I'll hand over to the Premier now and then happy to take questions.
Thanks very much, Chief Commissioner. Very briefly, because I know that you'll have questions, I just wanted to, on behalf of all Victorians, send our deepest sympathies to the family and friends of the 76-year-old man who has died as a result of this incident. Our hearts go out to them. They're in our thoughts and prayers at what will be a very, very difficult time for them. We also wanted to, on behalf of all Victorians, thank those three police members who very quickly and with great bravery did the most important work in terms of securing the scene and taking the suspect into custody. Beyond that, of course, fire, ambulance, all of our emergency services were on scene in good time, and I thank them for their very prompt response. Of course, to those hospital staff who are providing the very best of care to people who are injured, those three people and others who have been discharged since this incident, we thank them for their professionalism, their skill and the care that they're taking of those caught up in this terrible incident. And just finally, can I thank those many, many Victorians who were on scene and who stayed and extended that hand of friendship and love and support to try and comfort people and to be of any assistance possible. That's something that makes you very, very proud. If I can ask one further thing of people who were on scene, if you've got mobile phone footage, if you've got dash cam footage, or if you saw what happened, please call Crime Stoppers, 1-300. I asked this number beforehand and I knew I'd get it wrong. Call 1-800-333-000. Please ring that number. Your information, it might seem that everybody else saw what was going on and you don't need to reach out. Please do, because the information you have may be critical in piecing together what has happened here. So if you saw what happened, please reach out, call Crime Stoppers and provide your story and any footage that you have. But to all involved, this is a terrible incident and we are all deeply grateful to all of those who played a part in comforting others and, of course, coming to the aid of those who were caught up in it. I'm sure you'll have questions, so I'll throw back to the Chief now.
Thanks, Premier. Happy to take questions.
Suspect being held, which hospital? Can you clarify and whether you think there will be charges laid in the next 24 hours?
In respect to hospital, he's at the Royal Melbourne Hospital. He's under police guard. And in regards to charges, I can't say when charges or if they will be laid. The facts are simply that he's unfit for interview at this stage. But we'll continue that investigation. As I said, homicide has primacy.
Were there any reports of erratic driving or any clues in the lead-up?
We had absolutely no indication whatsoever of any prior erratic driving or any warning that this incident would occur. Police were not contacted at any stage and there have been no reports of any erratic driving or anything untoward.
Did he hold a Victorian driver's licence and did he have a record of, I know you said there was no record of anything like that, but speeding fines or any sort of road issues?
Yeah, I'm not familiar with his traffic history at this stage. That'll form part of the investigation.
Do you know if he had a Victorian driver's license?
No, I don't have that information.
He underwent a mental health assessment last night. I know you say he's unfit for interview. What is the state of his mental health?
The forensic medical officers have assessed him and said that his cognitive state is not such that he's able to properly participate in an interview and so therefore they've said we can't interview him, so he's under guard until such stage as we can.
Is there any indication of drugs?
And no, I've not been made aware of drug use or anything.
And the vehicle, was it his vehicle? Do we know? Or?
I'm advised the car was his mother's car.
Have you been to his house and searched his house and is there anything from that you've been able to do?
Yeah, because it's an active investigation, I'm not going to step into all the steps that homicide have taken and what they're taken, other than to say this is going to be a very thorough investigation. It will examine the totality of his history. It'll examine and try to find motives for why this has occurred and reasons why this has occurred, and, as I said, importantly, determine whether it's deliberate or reckless.
Have you ruled out terrorism so far, or is it just there's no indication yet?
At this stage, we've ruled out terrorism as being any factor in this. We have no indication at all of any terrorism.
In terms of the pedestrians, were they all waiting for a tram? They were near a tram stop, but were they crossing the road, or were they just simply waiting to get on the bus?
I believe the pedestrians were walking across at the time they were struck. And as I said, the car veered from the left to the right.
You said the police officers, when they found him, he was ranting. Is there any indication what he was saying?
He did make some comments, which will be quite important in us considering and working through what that means for the investigation and assessing as to whether there was intention or not to cause these injuries. But given the circumstances of the investigation, I'm not going to outline what those utterings were that he made.
Is it too early to say whether it was in fact deliberate?
Yeah, it's too early to say at this stage. I mean, that's a consideration, whether it's deliberate, whether it's reckless, it is too early to say. The importance of the crash reconstruction from our major collision, the importance of witness footage, the importance of delving into the background and what the triggers were that caused this incident, they're all factors we'll take into account.
You explained the suspect was part of a missing person report. Did he file that report, or was he the missing person?
No, he's not a missing person at this stage. The only record we have of this suspect in our holdings is that in the past he has been reported as a missing person. He's not currently a missing person, but in the past he has been reported as a missing person. And as I said, we had one involvement with him for a mental health transfer or a couple of involvements for that in the past.
So there are records of him being treated for mental health issues?
That's as I understand it, yes.
Were they recent?
Not since 2020 has Victoria Police had involvement with this male.
After 2017, there were bollards installed, to prevent these sort of incidents. Is there anything that more that could have been done, do you think, at all to prevent anything like this happening, or is it just something that can't be?
No, after 2017, obviously, there was a protective security committee that was led by government, and there were a range of protective measures put in place and bollards in a whole range of primary locations around the city based on expert advice. I'll refer to the Premier. Government led those, led those improvements, so he can speak to that. But as I understand it, what was done was the maximum that could be done to protect the city.
So, Premier? Let me just add to the Chief Commissioner's comments. Following 2017, there was a process, expert advice, security advice, engineering advice was sought, and in partnership with the City of Melbourne, more than $50 million was invested to essentially protect as best you can those pedestrian areas. That's principally footpaths and areas where there are no cars. If you're going to run a tram network, then obviously it gets incredibly difficult, or indeed if you're going to have roads that intersect each other, then you will always have pedestrian traffic. So it's challenging to go beyond what we've done, and we've done a lot. But if you're going to have a tram network and if you're going to have a functioning road network, then there is always a risk. That risk needs to be managed. But from an infrastructure point of view, I don't believe, and it's the judgment of experts in this field, that there's nothing more that can be done to avoid, for instance, an incident like this. An enormous amount of work was done following 2017, as was absolutely appropriate, but there's not an engineering treatment that we are advised about or aware of, or I think practical, that would change this outcome. Now, of course, a person has lost their life here, and the coroner will have a look at this, but I'm not aware of any further engineering treatment that we could put in place beyond the very substantial efforts we've already made. Just on the issue of, as well, about mental health, it's my advice that this suspect is not the subject of a mental health treatment order. Beyond that, I couldn't comment any further, but it's obviously, as the Chief Commissioner's made clear, mental illness may well be a factor in this.
If I remember correctly, in 2017, I think there was certainly a discussion of the retractable bollards protecting tram lines, particularly in the mall.
Yeah, and I think it was deemed that when you have to install those at every single tram stop, across every single intersection, to essentially prevent vehicles, any vehicle travelling up and down tram tracks, that would not be practical. Again, I'm happy to come back and I'll get you the relevant sections from the work that was done, but there was a very thorough process and $50+ million worth of bollards, important engineering treatments to fortify elements of the city, and going beyond that was deemed not possible, not because of budget or anything like that. It's just there's certain things are compatible with running a tram network and a road network, and certain things aren't. And to have retractable bollards at every single entrance, every possible place where cars might go up and down tram lines, gets very, very challenging.
I mean, what about there's regular calls to make the CBD more pedestrianised and to actually try and limit the amount of roads and areas where cars can drive. Do you think we've got the balance right there? There's obviously limits on Swanson Street and Bourke Street, but do you think there could be a
judgment? I don't think it's appropriate or particularly useful to use this terrible incident as a argument for or against the way in which the CBD works. I think we had a terrible incident, absolutely shocking, and today will be a traumatic time for many people caught up in that 2017 incident, and it'll be very, very challenging for them. Very substantial work based on the very best security engineering advice was done then. As I said, more than $50 million worth of effort, and it wasn't just the government, it was in consultation and a partnership with the City of Melbourne and indeed with law enforcement and others. I don't think that this particular incident is relevant to a broader discussion about what the speed limit should be in the city or how many cars there should be in the city. That's a separate issue and there are many different views on that.
Mr. Patton said Melbourne is still a very safe city, but can you understand the perception at the moment, given what's happened this weekend, obviously yesterday, of people starting to question whether Melbourne is safe to be around?
Well, again, the data and the facts are clear, but I can understand people would be concerned about this incident. I am. This is a very concerning incident. A person has died. A number of other people have been seriously injured. The question becomes what could be done to prevent it. And from an engineering point of view, the answer is I think we've done all that we can to fortify footpaths, to try and control the movement of traffic. If you're going to run a road network and if you're going to have uniquely trams running as well, then there will always be some risk. The question is, you have to manage that. And I believe that all the authorities, all the relevant authorities do their very best to manage that risk. I think it will be easier for us to draw broader conclusions, Nick, once what's occurred here has been properly investigated and once we have a clearer sense of what the person's motives were, what's happened before, all of those issues, what's led up to this, I mean. Unless and until we have that clearer picture, it's very difficult for us to draw broader conclusions. But again, I think Victoria Police do a fantastic job fighting crime, keeping our community safe. All of us are committed to playing our part, to doing everything we can to make sure that not just our capital city, but our whole state is as safe as possible. That's why we resource police appropriately. It's why the Minister has regular discussions with the Chief Commissioner and Police Command about new powers and new equipment, new ways of doing things. This is not a set and forget. It's every single day we're all working together in partnership constructively to try and make sure that we have the safest place for people to live and visit that we possibly can. But the work of police is challenging and it is a never-ending task.
Going back to the suspect's last interaction with police in 2024, this mental health check between then and now, is this an example of someone who could have and should have received more support or help from police between then and now?
It's too early for me to even comment on that. The reality is, the only records that we have of engagement with this male are in 2020, where we assisted with a mental health transfer, and I think prior to that as well. What treatment he's needed, what treatment he's received in that period, that'll all form part of the investigation and, as the Premier has said, a coronial investigation as well.
Just wanted to ask about the scene last night. You said there was three police officers that were there quite quickly, but did members of the public help out, and in what way did they assist on the scene?
Members of the public were there, and I think they were assisting. I don't have the exact details of that, but yes, members of the public, as I understand, did help out. There was also footage taken at the scene, which has some of it's already gone up to social media, as the Premier has said, and we would urge people with that footage to contact Crime Stoppers and provide that.
Could you just go through the movement of the three vehicles on the intersection of Russell Street again? You mentioned one was travelling north. Was the other one coming south on Russell Street?
I understand it was turning, and this might not be exact, but I think it was turning left into Russell Street to head north from Bourke. But as I said, the aim of the major collision investigation unit will be to completely reconstruct that, which will allow them then to assess what speed, the actual point of impact, and determine fully what's transpired there, which is so important to assist the homicide in their investigation.
Can you go over his movements as far as we know prior to hitting Bourke Street? You said it was sort of Elizabeth
then? As far as his movements that I've been briefed at this stage, he's turned right from Elizabeth Street into Bourke Street. He's continued up the tram tracks, travelling east in the mall. He's crossed over Swanson Street, and as he's crossed over outside the Telstra building, he's veered from the left to the right of the tram tracks and collided with those three pedestrians. He's then accelerated from there and T-boned a vehicle at the intersection of Russell Street.
So he went through the mall, sorry, am I correct? He actually went through the mall?
That's what I said, yes.
So this could have been, terrible what's occurred, but it could have been even worse if he's gone through the mall.
I think the treatments that have been put in place in the mall would prohibit accessing all the pedestrians on the other side from the infrastructure improvements that were made last time. There's a lot of work, both subtle and obvious, that has taken place there, which are the protections that were put in place in accordance with the Australian New Zealand Counterterrorism Crowded Places guidelines and all the expert advice.
Do you have any indication at this stage where he came from and, his route into the city or whatever, and beyond, you're just incredible on the radar?
We don't at this stage. I mean, the homicide squad will collect the footage from all the safe city cameras, which is an extensive network, so that will give us great advice and coverage as to where he's came from. Obviously, we'll check a whole range of things to determine his route, how he came to be in the city, via City Link and a whole range of things. So there's many avenues, and we will establish that in due course. But at this early stage, all I know is that he has came from Elizabeth Street and turned into Bourke Street Mall.
And why don't we know if he had a licence yet? Was that not an initial sort of thing to look at, or is that a different department?
Whether he holds a licence will form part of the investigation, but the primary focus for us is about the tragic death of a male, three people, innocent bystanders, who've been struck by a car and in hospital, seriously injured. Of course, the totality of the incident will be assessed. Whether he had a licence will form part of that.
And sorry, forgive me if you've my mentions before, but is there any estimate on what speed he was actually doing in the course of the trip up?
This is only an estimate, and so this may well not be accurate, but someone has stated that it's possible he was doing around 60 to 70 kilometres an hour at near the end of his journey, near the point of impact. But that may not be accurate. That will form part of the reconstruction.
He's getting faster and faster in the course of the trip.
He accelerated after striking the pedestrians.
Were there any calls to police from Bourke Street Mall when he was going through the mall?
I'm not aware of any calls being made from that, no.
Can I ask you the same question I asked the Premier? Can you understand the perception of Melbourne at the moment from what happened this weekend, yesterday, and I also understand something else today as well? Can you understand the perception of Melbourne, that Melburnians being scared and a bit reticent to come into the city at the moment?
Oh, I can certainly understand people being concerned, but that's why we have the visibility. That's why we're out there doing everything we can. As the Premier has said, it is a very challenging role, policing, but by and large, Melbourne is one of the safest cities in the world. Every city in the world faces challenges such as what we've seen last night. We've seen car attacks overseas. We've seen reckless driving overseas. Victoria Police will do what we can. When you're referencing back to the incident at Glenira, a really vicious robbery that occurred, We've already arrested one offender for that. We know who the other offenders are. We are actively chasing them down and will continue to do so. We know that the robberies are certainly down from 2020, from pre-COVID, but we'll continue to do that and what we can, and we will continue to provide that assurance to the public. But of course, people will feel concern when incidents like this happen. It's human nature, of course it will.
There's reports this morning that three people have been shot in Kiel or having breakfast. Are you aware of this incident?
I've just prior to coming in here, I've been briefed that, as I understand, at Kiel or Village, a male in his 50s has been shot and may have passed away, and another male at the scene has also been shot, as I believe, in the stomach, and two offenders have ran from the scene and gone in a vehicle. Homicides obviously turning out to that, and other support services.
Just on the suspect, do we know, was he born in Australia? Or?
Yes, he's born in Australia.
Premier, can I ask you one question on sure. The perception? You're in the process of winding back bail laws, and I know in this particular case the suspect had not been on bail, but it's obviously tied with the Gagas Orwards. Are you worried about the perception of those changes and changing the... responsibility and perception of those at this time?
Well, a couple of points. I wouldn't necessarily describe the changes to bail the way that you've described them, Nick, but we have, even after making changes about breaches of bail being a specific offence, we'll still have the toughest bail laws in our country, and that's an appropriate thing. But it's not the government that will make those changes. The Parliament will make those changes. We do not have a majority in the upper house of the Parliament, and it'll be for the Parliament to make those changes and any other changes. In relation to raising the age, our proposal, which has been criticised by many as not going far enough, principally in the first instance deals with 11 and 12-year-olds, and I think we could all agree that we want to see 11 and 12-year-olds at school, not necessarily at crime school, but at school learning. In terms of older young people, then that would be part of a second phase to be dealt with in 2027 only, so unless and until and only if we have done the very hard work to deliver an alternative service model. You can't have nothing. Something has to take the place of a custodial environment. And there's a lot of hard work to be done in that. That is not an easy task, but it's one that we think is important, and it's one that I hope there would be some bipartisan support for, because it's pretty obvious to, I think, most fair-minded people that... patterns of bad behaviour normally only go one way. And if you don't intervene and if you don't provide people with options and support to make much better choices for them, for their family and for the community that they're a member of, then their behaviour simply escalates at often very significant human cost, but also the monetary cost is just, it is enormous, the amount of money that we finish up having to spend because we didn't intervene earlier. Again, that's all part of the second phase. That's some years off, and there's an enormous amount of work, a huge amount of work to be done between now and then, and it's only if that work is done to our satisfaction that we will proceed. It's got to be done safely. It's got to be done properly. Just on the broader issue of what occurred last night, I referred to the coroner. The coroner, without fear or favour, will look at what's happened here. And if they have any recommendations about any further fortifications or anything that might be done differently, then, of course, the government always stands ready to implement any findings that the coroner hands down. But it's not obvious to us, it's not readily apparent to us that the engineering works that we did.
And that is where we will leave the Premier and Chief Commissioner addressing the media this morning. Just in terms of the suspect, to recap, who was driving that white Toyota, he is in hospital, in the Royal Melbourne Hospital, under police guard. He is unable to be interviewed at the moment. We do know he is a 26-year-old from Melton West with no criminal history, and police have ruled out terrorism at this stage. We will keep you updated throughout the day, and then join us for 7 News at 6.